All the movies that he's been in, we've seen him on TV for years, is that he's a great hockey fan and a great friend of Cam Neely's. In fact, you were there the night that they retired as number 8.
Yeah, I was honored that Cam asked me to say a couple words and introduce him, and it was a big night. And it was a kind of a, that night I remember thinking about this night, thinking, you know, we were saying what's next is the Hall of Fame, and he's just such a deserving guy, and it's such a great honor, and we're all excited to be here.
You know, you're a Burnaby boy. Do you ever wonder what would have happened had the Canucks not traded him away?
You know, it's funny. I was talking to somebody about it today, and, you know, you kind of feel bad for Peterson after a while, you know? I mean, this is a quality player. You know, had a nice career. It just happened to be on the other side of a deal that seems lopsided now when you look at it, obviously. But, yeah, I mean, it's amazing. Not only did they get Cam, but they had Wesley. An amazing deal.
I'm from Vancouver as well. Don't bring it up. It still hurts, though, to the Lower Mainland.
Well, you don't know if he would have turned into Cam Neely in Vancouver. I mean, it was a different system, and he was being used in a different way, and he was young, and he didn't know how to assert himself yet at that point. And it was just a great fit with Boston. So it was just one of those things where it just worked out.
Enjoy the night, and thank you very much for your time, Michael.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Gino?
Some good analysis there by Michael J. Fox. Hey, a reminder, Molson, that's hockey coming up tomorrow. We've got regional coverage of the Toronto Maple Leafs. We'll preview them and the Caps for you. Then at 9:30, a special edition of Molson That's Hockey following the Bruins and Flyers game. That's tomorrow on TSN. He was a Soviet superstar.
Harlamov goes down over the line, cutting in around Laurie, a shot, he scores!
Combining skill and intelligence, he established himself as a force for the Soviet Red Army before leaping onto the international stage. A look back at the career of Valery Harlamov is next.
Closed captioning of this TSN program is brought to you in part by Viera Flat Panel TV from Panasonic, Ideas for Life.
I'm proud.
I'm proud.
I'm proud of our continued commitment to quality.
I'm proud to bring the most exciting new 2006 models.
And in addition to this incredible lineup, we're introducing a new approach.
We've redesigned 15 models, added features.
And we've adjusted prices on many of our vehicles.
We're committed to giving you more in our 2006s. It's all part of our assurance
that you'll get more value in every GM vehicle.
That's the GM commitment.
The Con. Put your money where your mouth is. An underworld gambling ring takes center stage, and the fight is about to begin. Featuring deep character customization and unique betting elements. Only for the PlayStation Portable. The Con. Rated T for Teen. Available at Walmart.
Rocking around the Christmas tree at the Christmas party hop. Mistletoe hung. Couple tries to stop. You will get a sentimental feeling when you hear voices singing, let's be jolly, deck the halls with boughs of holly.
You may wonder, who would get a payday loan? Fact is, good people. Unexpectedly short between paychecks. Banks, family, friends may not be the answer. So what do you do? Go to Money Mart. Millions have for more than 20 years. They're open late every day, usually right around the corner. And a Money Mart payday loan costs less. Check their online calculator. You'll be surprised. So who uses Money Mart? Could be you.
Gino Retta's clothing provided by Copley.
A forward with the Central Red Army through the 1970s, Valery Harlamov played in an era when Soviet players were not allowed in the NHL. North American fans missed out because Harlamov is considered one of the most creative players ever to lace up a pair of skates. He took the hockey world by storm in the 1972 Summit Series. A relative unknown on this side of the ocean, Harlamov potted two goals in the Soviets' Game 1 victory and had 7 points in the first 7 games of the series. Canada considered Harlamov so dangerous, it sent out Bobby Clark, who made the infamous ankle chop that injured Harlamov and forced him out of the series. Harlamov played on 11 Red Army Championship teams and won 8 world titles and 2 Olympic gold medals with the Soviets. In 1981, Harlamov was killed in a car accident in his native Russia. He was only 33. Valery Harlamov to be inducted in the players category. And we're now joined live by Harry Sinnott, a gentleman who's got connection to a couple of this year's inductees. He was the man who made the deal to bring Cam Neely to the Boston Bruins. He was also the head coach for Team Canada back in 1972 that had to face Valery Harlamov. How much, if anything, did you guys know about Harlamov before you actually had to play against the Russians?
We knew very little. We understood he was one of the best players on their team, he and Yakishev. We got a pretty good report on the goaltender. Actually, it was a pretty bad report on Tretiak. But other than that, we didn't have a lot of information.
How much did you know about him after the series? Because he was, if you watch the video now of the 72 series, absolutely electrifying is the word that comes to mind when this guy had the puck.
You know, you're right on. I mean, he's like a combination of Pavel Bure and Joe Sakic, and he was a great defensive player, too. Our wingers couldn't get away from him, so you know they had trouble playing against him as well as watching, guarding him. And the players on the Team Canada team, some of the defensemen, Hall of Fame defensemen like Serge Savard, they rank him with the best players they've ever played against.
So good that you guys had to take him out. Now, what part did you play in all that? Everybody says it was John Ferguson.
I plead the fifth on this. I didn't know anything about it. And he played the next game after he supposedly got hurt. He did get hurt. He played the next game, then missed the following one. So I don't know what happened.
So the tapes have all been erased then? No one's ever going to confess on this?
Not me, anyway.
Harry, thanks a lot for this. We appreciate it. Enjoy the night.
Thanks, Harry. Thank you.
Harry Sinnott, who's pleading the fifth. He's not going to go anywhere near that comment whatsoever. Hey, folks, a reminder, coming up next this week on the NHL on TSN, we got 3 games for you. Bruins and Flyers tomorrow, the Leafs and Capitals regional coverage, and then it's LA and Detroit coming up on Wednesday. It's all on the NHL on TSN. The class of 2005 is set to be inducted, but what will happen in 2007? Stevens, Messier, Francis, who will get the call from a bumper crop of Hall of Fame potential?
We couldn't lose. We had the Maple Leaf on our jerseys. The Royal Bank helped pay our way to the games. We won gold.
What I do takes discipline. RBC helped fund snowboarding through 2010. My job is to go big or go home. RBC support helps me do my job.
RBC, putting athletes first since 1947.
For best new fashion in denim. It's way out of your league, girl, for Old Navy boycott denim. It's who knew she was so cute for boycott denim. I know why you're so cute. And girl you broke up with, it was the biggest mistake of your life for boycott denim. Get over here, you. The cut says boy, but the look is all girl. I should have worn jeans. Get glam for the holidays with Old Navy boycott denim, only $34.50.
Hey, Ed. Check this out. good idea.
Why not?
Ice cold Coors Light, the silver bullet.
Molson That's Hockey is brought to you by Molson Canadian.
After a brief NHL career in the early 1950s, Murray Costello made his greatest contributions to the game during his 19 years as president of Hockey Canada. Under his leadership, the Canadian Amateur Hockey Association was merged with Hockey Canada to create a unified and efficient system for hockey development in this country. Costello might be best remembered for his role in creating the Canadian National Women's Team and the World Women's Hockey Championship Tournament. The number of participants in the women's game in Canada has grown sevenfold since the first Worlds were played in 1990. Murray Costello to be inducted in the Builders category. Back now live at the Hockey Hall of Fame. Now, Bob, earlier in the show, you kind of piqued my interest. You said that at one point, Murray Costello totally made a fool out of you. I got to ask you about that.
Well, it was in the aftermath of 1987, the Piashtani punch-up, and a lot of the Canadian players that were involved in that were suspended from international play. So it had gone on and gone on and gone on. And I was writing a column in the Hockey News in the aftermath of that. It was coming up towards the next World Juniors in 88. And I was saying, you know what? Murray Costello is a gentleman, is a scholar, but it's time for a little jackboot diplomacy. And it may be a guy like Alan Eagleson to go in and threaten to pull us out of international hockey and do all those types of things. And that maybe Murray's a little too soft for this thing. We need a harder guy in there fighting on Canada's behalf. Well, I was on my way home from having written the story. The paper had gone to press, and about an hour afterwards, I was driving home, and on the radio, I heard that all the Canadian players had been reinstated, and the International Ice Hockey Federation said that it was the wonderful diplomacy and intelligence and patience of a guy like Murray Costello. And the newspaper hadn't even hit the stands, and I was already 180 degrees wrong. And you know what? Murray is a gentleman and a scholar.
Nothing like nailing a story, eh, Bobby?
Right on.
Speaking of the story, there's a rule change coming up in the National Hockey League. Let's talk about that.
Well, if anybody saw the game between Los Angeles and Nashville on the weekend, they saw Jeremy Roenick on a shootout goal, and it was basically a double tap. Now, you had to look at the replay about 90 times to see this. The referee tried to call up for a review of the goal, but it's not reviewable. Now, shootout goals are reviewable, but a double tap is not. There are 7 criteria to determine whether or not a goal counts in the National Hockey League in terms of a video review. A double tap and how it got into the net is not one of them. So what's happening right now is National Hockey League Hockey Operations putting together an 8th criteria, which is basically an all-inclusive, did the puck go correctly or legally into the net? This can't happen immediately. It's got to be passed by the NHL Board of Governors, but the NHL wants this to happen as quickly as possible. Could take a week, could take 2 weeks, maybe at the most a month. But in any case, sometime during this season, the rule will be changed to allow for video review of a lot of other criteria for whether the puck gets in the net, and that's a good thing.
Are we looking at a number of different criteria that could be introduced, or will it be one that will be vague enough?
It's going to be vague enough to say, did the puck go correctly or legally into the net, and that will encompass things like the double tap that previously didn't have a spot in the rule book.
So as we induct here in the Hockey Hall of Fame, the NHL continues to evolve into a better and better game. Hey, it's been a lot of fun. For Bob McKenzie, James Duthie, Dave Randorf, I'm Gino Retta. Coming up next, it's the Hockey Hall of Fame induction ceremonies here on TSN. Then it's this corner with Darren Attischen and Russ Amber, followed by Raw and then Dutch and Hedge at the next edition of SportsCenter. Stick around. Live induction ceremony from the Hockey Hall of Fame is coming up next on TSN.
TSN's Canadian Chopper Challenge, Saturday at 8 on TSN.
Get it at the net. All that matters. That's an easy goal for a big goal scorer.
The Hockey Hall of Fame stands as a tribute to the history of the great game of hockey. History that is defined by the legends who inhabit these walls. Each plaque signifies the contributions that these select individuals have made to their chosen sport. Tonight, the Hockey Hall of Fame opens its doors to 3 new members who left their own indelible mark on the game of hockey. The vision and leadership of Murray Costello, the smooth playmaking ability of Valery Harlamov, and the combination of power and finesse of Cam Neely. Each man has enriched the game. And tonight, the game gives something back to them as they are rewarded for their contributions by receiving the ultimate honor the game has to give. Induction into the Hockey Hall of Fame. From Toronto, it's the 2005 Hockey Hall of Fame induction ceremony. Please welcome your hosts, Nick Urban and John Wells.
Good evening and welcome to the 2005 Hockey Hall of Fame induction ceremony. Tonight we welcome three new members and look back on careers as they enter this great fraternity. And here with me once again, my co-host and a broadcaster who is already in this Hall of Fame and has earned his special place here, Dick Urban.
Thank you, John. You don't get any shorter, you know, over the years, as they. It's my pleasure to be here in one of my favorite events on the hockey calendar. We all love stories with happy endings or where the good guys win. And this evening delivers on that sentiment, staging much-deserved storybook endings to three remarkable careers in hockey.
Tonight, three good guys win the ultimate recognition of their peers and their entire sport. The names Costello, Harmelov, and Neely will take their special place among the legends like Orr and Howe and Gretzky and Tretiak.
Of our inductees tonight, one showed North Americans that hockey was a worldwide phenomenon, and his brilliance proved it wasn't only our game. Another's love of the game nurtured hockey, his initiatives bettering the sport throughout the world. And one simply had enough heart to power an entire team, and you knew he'd be here someday, and like all happy endings, he is.
So let's get on with the evening and start by introducing a man who has his name on the Calder and Stanley Cups here in the Hockey Hall of Fame, the Hall's chairman and CEO, Mr. Bill Hay.
Thank you very much. Commissioner Bettman, President Fizell, honored members, ladies and gentlemen. This night has a distinct international flavor as we welcome three new honored members. Valerie Harlamov was one of the best to ever play the game. His grace, skill, and artistry were admired and feared by all opponents. Cam Neely was a star with the Boston Bruins, but off the ice, he became a bigger star. The Cam Neely Foundation has raised more than $11 million to fight cancer and operates a home away from home for cancer patients and their families. Congratulations, Cam, for your great work. Murray Costello came from a hockey family. His family, his teammates, and his critics all agree that Murray was a better executive than a hockey player. His moves on the ice were all by committee. I want to offer my personal thanks to our sponsors as well as the Hockey Hall of Fame Board of Directors, the Selection Committee, senior executives, and the staff for their service during a difficult year. Welcome to tonight's induction ceremonies as we honor the legend, the sniper, and the organizer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bill. And now here's James Duthie with a special guest. James?
All right, thank you, John. With someone that you all recognize from his movies, his TV shows, his comedy, and you might also know that he's a huge hockey fan, a long-time, long-suffering, some might say, Bruins fan, Dennis Leary, and also a long-time friend of Cam Neely. Let's remove your friendship for a second. I want to ask you this question just as a Boston Bruins fan. What was the coolest part about watching Cam Neely play?
I think my favorite thing about Cam was when he would come down the right side, for instance, in 1988 against the Canadiens in the playoffs. The Bruins ended up beating the Canadiens that year. Cam gets the puck in his own end, he comes across center ice, and there's one Canadian between him and the net, Peter Svoboda. Now, Svoboda's on his haunches coming backwards, thinking like, I'm gonna let Cam make the first move. And you can see that Cam's getting closer to him, and Cam's probably thinking, what am I gonna do? And Cam's move is to knock Svoboda down. His helmet came off, looked like his head came off. Cam turned into the faceoff circle and scored upper left corner. So, you know, you ask Cam, like, what was that move? That was a Cam Neely move. Knock him down.
He was perfect for Boston, wasn't he? Because for that kind of town and the fans there, he was really the second coming of Terry O'Reilly.
Yeah, and he could score 50 goals a year. I mean, he really was, once he came to Boston, that town fell in love with him. It wasn't just the goal scoring, it was the heart, you know, it was the grit. He would stick up for his teammates, he would fight for his team, he would, you know, he'd beat you in the corner, he'd beat you, and then sit in the box and come out and score two goals. So,
I'd be remiss that I didn't ask you, as an actor, of course, Cam, very famous for a performance. His subtle yet poignant performance as Seabass in Dumb and Dumber. Is it not one of the most important roles in the history of American cinema?
It was so impressive that I actually hired him for my show, Rescue Me. And I got to say, honestly, the guy, is, as an actor, nothing bothers him. He just goes out and he does whatever speech you give him. And, granted, on my show, he's playing a hockey player. But I've said this once, I'll say it again. If he wins an Emmy before I do, I quit everything. I quit everything. The Hall of Fame should be enough, Cam.
Dennis, thank you very much
You're
for
welcome.
This.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Murray Costello dreamed of a career in hockey. His vision helped shape the Canadian game for generations to follow. A lifelong hockey man enters the hall when we return.
The 2005 Hockey Hall of Fame induction ceremony is brought to you by Molson Canadian. By the Kodak EasyShare system, digital pictures made simple. By Hugo Boss. By the Royal Canadian Mint. And by RBC, putting athletes first since 1947.
True Canadian taste from Canada's oldest brewery, it starts here.
Who put this music on?
Molson Canadian Lager.
We got a report on a missing computer.
I don't understand.
This is a digital camera.
Right.
And this is a digital printer.
Right.
Then where's the computer?
There isn't one.
No computer. So where did the pictures come from? Simple.
The Kodak EasyShare camera and printer dock. Real Kodak pictures, real simple.
But that still doesn't explain what happened to the computer.
It doesn't?
Keep it simple. Keep it Kodak. Fragrance for men.
What inspires gratitude? The Royal Canadian Mint presents this 25-cent coin to commemorate the Year of the Veteran, an opportunity to honor the veterans of yesterday, today, and tomorrow.
We thought it was important to serve, and I'd do it again.
I wanted to do my part. It's something I really believe in.
Collect this circulation coin to remember their contributions and sacrifices. Salute all veterans with this unique collectible from your change.
It's the start of a brand new hockey season, and what better way to celebrate than Hockey Canada Week? From November 5th to November 12th, Hockey Canada is hosting a series of events and programs across the country. Some of the key events this year include development festivals, where coaches, players, and officials have a chance to get together and work on skill development. Whether it's skating instruction or specialized skills practices, there's numerous opportunities for players to have fun while learning something new about the game of hockey. One of the more popular off-ice activities is the iTech Design a Mask Contest. For the third consecutive year, young hockey fans are encouraged to design a Canadian-themed goalie mask. The winning designs will be worn by Team Canada's goaltenders at the upcoming 2006 World Junior Championship in Vancouver. Whether you're a player, coach, or parent, there are many fun activities to participate in during this year's Hockey Canada Week.
Thank you, Rod. Our first inductee tonight is in the builder category. And build he did indeed. Chances are, if you've played the game or have been a hockey fan over the last 25 years, you've been the beneficiary of this man's dedication and his passion. A career in hockey included 3 years as an NHL player in the 1950s, serving as an executive in junior hockey, helping establish the WHA, serving terms with the International Ice Hockey Federation, and they've all gone to deepen his love and appreciation of his sport. His crowning glory, however, is his 19-year term as president of the Canadian Amateur Hockey Association, now known as Hockey Canada. During his time there, he established a standardized developmental program for all players and fostered Canada's tremendously successful women's hockey program. But for parents and kids who played at any level, thanks to Murray Costello, hockey became a better, a safer game to play. Tonight, we welcome Murray Costello into the Hockey Hall of Fame.
Growing up in South Porcupine, Ontario, Murray Costello dreamed of a career playing hockey and following his brother Les to play in the NHL. Murray did end up with a hockey career, but it was different than the one he envisioned on the outdoor rinks of South Porcupine. The early part of Murray's life in hockey followed the script he had imagined. He made his NHL debut in 1953 as a member of the Chicago Blackhawks, scoring 3 goals. He spent parts of the next 2 NHL seasons with Boston and Detroit. But the NHL career he dreamed of wasn't living up to his expectations. Murray took a bold step and decided to take a year off from hockey so he could be reinstated as an amateur.
I turned pro at 19 and retired at 24 because I felt, having had a shot with 3 of the NHL teams, and there were only 6, that they were delivering a message to me. I was never going to be the star that I thought I might have been, so I thought I better get on with something else. So I quit to go back to school. And after a year, I was reinstated as an amateur and played some senior hockey.
Murray spent the next 4 years playing for the Windsor Bulldogs before retiring in 1962. His playing days were over, but Murray's greatest contributions to hockey were still to come. After returning to school and earning a degree in law, Murray returned to the game he loved in an administrative capacity. After holding posts as publicity director of the Western Hockey League and general manager of the Seattle Entry in the WHL, Murray was elected president of the Canadian Amateur Hockey Association in 1979.
I thought it was a good opportunity. I had a fair amount of experience in the game up until that time, and I thought it's a way to stay in the game and that perhaps I could use some of my legal knowledge too to make the job worthwhile. I really didn't think it would be a career move, but as it turned out, I was there almost 20 years.
As president of hockey's governing body in Canada, Murray oversaw some changes that have had a huge impact on hockey in this country. He introduced the National Women's Hockey Team and hosted the first Women's World Hockey Championship in Ottawa in 1990. As almost a direct result of that, women's hockey has exploded. Today, over 65,000 women play hockey in Canada, compared to only 9,000 in 1990.
The programs here have just flourished beautifully. The young girls have taken to the game, and they absolutely love playing it in every bit the same way as do the guys. And with the work ethic of Canada and Canadians to this game, they have really accomplished and play at a skill level that I really didn't think possible 15 years ago.
In addition to the development of women's hockey, Murray helped merge the Canadian Amateur Hockey Association and Hockey Canada into one entity, the Canadian Hockey Association. It helped streamline the development of hockey in Canada so that players and coaches at all levels were working together with a unified message.
There was a problem all along to have 2 separate organizations trying to essentially accomplish the same job. It was difficult, particularly in the development end. We in the old Canadian Amateur Hockey Association felt that Hockey Canada would come in with the big events like the Canada Cups and kind of cream the system, and the development side of it didn't share in that nearly as what they should. And so when we brought it together in one organization, and I credit Bill Hay as being the guy who was able to see through that and work with me to try and get one development stream, it made a really big difference.
For 19 years, Murray Costello was at the helm of hockey in Canada. He retired in 1998, but his contributions to the game continue. The structures he put in place are the building blocks that have helped Canada succeed in developing players and winning championships. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Murray Costello, inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame in the Builder category.
Let me begin, ladies and gentlemen, by congratulating Cam Neely and the Harlemov family for being here. It's a pleasure to share this podium with you tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a pretty heavy trip for a guy from South Porcupine, Ontario. But I can tell you that I understand this is recognition of the amateur side of the game and for the many thousands of volunteers who continue to make it happen year after year across Canada. Once again, I get to take the bow on their behalf because they do the work out there and our system is strong because of it. I'd like to mention many, many names to you tonight because they do such good work out there, but time doesn't allow. I will only mention three or four. The first is Gord Renwick of Cambridge, Ontario. Gord is not with us tonight because he's out of the country, but he's the guy who first kind of handpicked me to get involved on the amateur side of the game. And the other guy is Frank McKinnon from Carman, Manitoba. Frank convinced me to interview for the job and signed me to my first contract. I didn't think it would last, but Frank, that was an astute move. We both benefited greatly from it. Moving along, the game, you know, there's so much has happened in it. Some of them, a lot of things were the good, and I'm very pleased about that. But there's two guys outside the immediate system that were very helpful, too. The program of excellence, particularly the advent of the national junior team, really made a difference to what we were doing. And the guy that helped so much with that was my working partner, Ed Chenoweth, of the Canadian Hockey League, the commissioner, and president of the Western Hockey League. He sold the major junior operators into releasing their players in mid-season to perform for Canada. That made a big difference in our programs because club teams could no longer compete at that level. We had to go with the national team. And that's grown bigger and better ever since, and I'm very pleased and proud of that. The other was bringing the two organizations together. Bill Hayes saw the wisdom of one development stream instead of two competing bodies. That worked very well, and since that happened in about 1994, they've been able to take it to a higher level of development ever since, and that too is very good. On the more personal side, I grew up in a family of five kids, a girl followed by four boys. There's only three of us left, myself and my sister, the oldest, Rita. It's great to have Rita here sharing this moment with me. And at the other end, my youngest brother, Jack. Jack was a great coach and knew more about this game than I will ever know and has been a great sounding board for me over the years. So it's great to share this with you tonight, Jack. And of course, two brothers who are gone. My brother closest to me, Don, they called him Moose. He left us before he turned 65, but I'm very pleased that his son, Johnny, is with me tonight. That means a lot to me, John, to have you here. And of course, some of you have heard of Father Les of Flying Father's fame. He kind of set the tone and the attitude toward the game in our household, and that was to enjoy it because it's only a game, play it to the fullest, and laugh as much as you can along the way. And it wasn't a bad philosophy to follow, and I think it sustained us through a lot of times. Looking to my more immediate family, I'm most pleased to find that all six of my kids are with me tonight, including two of our five grandchildren, Matthew and Jimmy. It's good to have you as part of this evening. But Michelle and Dan, Jennifer and Jim, and the twins, Mary and Elizabeth, I'm happy you're here because I've missed so many of your events. You know, I've always felt there's only a select few of us across Canada who have been able to take our childhood passion for a game, turn it into a lifelong livelihood, and then be rewarded for it when it's over. That's all well and good, but it does cause some grief and some stress on the home front. And when that happens, and you have that kind of job, you've got to have a quarterback, a general, maybe even a commander-in-chief on the home front to make that happen. And, you know, I've always said there are life partners, there are supporting life partners, and in my case, there's someone above all of that in my life partner and wife, Denise. Denise, I thank you for what you've done. I love you for it, and I love you most of all for not changing the locks after some of those road trips. Along with that, ladies and gentlemen, the board of directors here at the Hall of Fame, I've been able to serve on this board since 1979 when Clarence Campbell used to chair the meetings. Then it was through the Brian O'Neill era, the Scotty Morrison era, and now the Bill Hay era, and that's been a delightful time, and I thank the board members for allowing my name to go forward. Among those board members, one of the newer ones is the president of the International Ice Hockey Federation, Dr. Rene Fussell. Rene, it's good to have you with us tonight, and I thank you for allowing me to become a member of the Council of the IHF to work with you, and that's ongoing, and I'm enjoying it immensely. It's just great. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, the staff at this hall is amazing, led by Jeff Denemy, but particularly Kelly Massey, Pearl, the Craigs, the Phils, Darren Boyko and all in between. They do so much for us each time in, but this weekend has been outstanding. I can tell you that a guy could get used to living like this. So I thank you very much for a wonderful evening, and for all the rest of you, ladies and gentlemen, an honor like this is truly difficult to comprehend. I can only say very, very seriously and with much humility, I thank you so much for allowing me to become a member of this builder section. It's a wonderful, wonderful way to top a career. Thank you so much.
The game of hockey has ignited a passion all over the world. Some of the game's most memorable moments have occurred on the international stage. The Hockey Hall of Fame pays tribute to the global game when we return.
We couldn't lose. We had the Maple Leaf on our jerseys. The Royal Bank helped pay our way to the games. We won gold.
What I do takes discipline. RBC helps fund snowboarding through 2010.
My job is to go big or go home. RBC support helps me do my job.
RBC, putting athletes first since 1947.
Jeez, that's a big truck.
Biggest cab, the all-new Dodge Ram Mega Cab.
Where's the truck?
Yeah, it's that big.
Fresh paint and new carpet. Now that's what I call decorating for the holidays.
Deck your halls with style that's always in season. Now through Sunday, get no payments, no interest for 12 months on select purchases of $450 or more when you use your Home Depot credit card. Decorate your home with new flooring or windows that will brighten your home all year round. You can at the Home Depot.
The Home Depot. You can do it, we can help.
Create your destiny. Yeah! Soul Calibur returns with a new character creation mode, 3 new warriors, and endless possibilities. Soul Calibur 3, rated teen.
This week on Choices, a young woman has a Wendy's classic single combo and a dilemma. Pick one of 5 delicious sides at no extra cost. But who's it gonna be?
Ma'am? Caesar side salad.
Do Wendy's, do what tastes right.
The popularity of hockey continues to grow with each passing year. But North America isn't the only place that has embraced the game. The globalization of hockey has been going on for decades as countries from all over the world have written their own chapters in this great sport. In recognition of the ever-expanding international game, the Hockey Hall of Fame, in partnership with the IIHF, relaunched the Royal Canadian Mint World of Hockey Zone. The exhibit originally opened in 1998, but this year renovations added an additional 1,000 square feet. The newly expanded World of Hockey Zone features histories and exhibit materials from all IIHF member countries. Prominence is given to World and Olympic championships, including a display paying tribute to the contributions of the Czech Republic, the reigning men's world champions. The centerpiece of the redesigned exhibit is the IIHF Honor Roll. Here, hockey fans can see and recognize the names who helped shape the history of the international game. The World of Hockey Zone provides hockey fans an opportunity to walk through history as they see the artifacts of the game up close. Some of hockey's greatest moments have happened on the international stage, and now fans have a place to relive their favorite memories of the game.
5 seconds left in the game. Over. You believe in miracles? Yes! Unbelievable.
Each year, the inductees to the Hockey Hall of Fame prove the game has truly become a worldwide phenomenon. NHL stars and new Hall of Fame members are coming from all corners of the planet at an impressive rate. Events like the World Championships and the upcoming Winter Olympic Games in Turin, Italy, continue to promote the sport and increase its exciting international flavor. To further that trend tonight, we welcome a special guest who's a member of the board of directors and a great friend of the Hockey Hall of Fame, the president of the International Ice Hockey Federation, Rennie Fussell.
Bonsoir, mesdames, bonsoir, messieurs, dear inductees, families, guests of honors, and hockey friends. It is only fitting that Valery Kharlamov is inducted in an Olympic year, since so much of his magic was performed at the Winter Olympic Games 72, 76, and 80. But unlike today, Olympic hockey did not have extensive exposure in Canada in those days. So for most Canadian hockey fans, the 72 Summit Series was the eye-opener to a different brand of hockey, featuring world-class performers like the speedy little Russian winger we honor today. The Canadian hockey fans saw a player with a unique style, and as we know now, it took special means to stop him. The 72 series showed that it takes two qualities to be successful, speed and skill. Murray Costello was one of the first to realize that an emphasis on skill development was the best way to bring the motherland of hockey back to the top of the international game. The junior program and the program of excellence, which Murray was instrumental in initiating, are two of the main reasons that Canadian national teams on all levels are winning gold medals today and doing so in style, with speed and skill. I can't begin to express, dear Murray, how fortunate we are to have you on the IHF Council. As we all know, you can't win with speed and skill alone. In hockey, you also need grit, determination, and courage. All these qualities are exemplified by Cam Neely, whose career should have been much longer than it was. On behalf of the International Ice Hockey Federation, I would like to congratulate the inductees, the families, for this great, great honor. Thank you very much. Thank you.
You know, along with a lot of other people, I vividly recall laying eyes on tonight's first player inductee on one of the most memorable experiences of my career. It was September 2nd, 1972, and indeed a tension-filled evening at the old Montreal Forum, the anticipated start to the now mythical Summit Series. On the Soviet national squad, one player stood out. He had the finesse of an oar, the grit and drive of a Cornouiller, yet brought a flair and sense of anticipation that was totally unique at that time. That night in Montreal, where number 17 scored two quick goals to seal the game and set the tone for the entire series, was merely his North American debut. For years before, and the decade following, this revolutionary hockey talent was the shining star on the international hockey scene. But something magical happened during September in 1972, even though he was from the other team. Opponents and North American fans acknowledged his brilliance. The aesthetics of his game and his teammates added something totally new to hockey's great vocabulary. The hockey world was deeply saddened when his life tragically ended in 1981. But that same fraternity celebrates tonight as one of the greatest players of his era, Valery Kharlamov, takes his place in the Hockey Hall of Fame.
Statistics, numbers, they define most players' careers. If those numbers are good enough, they may gain entry into the Hockey Hall of Fame. Since Valery Kharlamov did not play in the NHL, few people know how many goals he scored or how many points he accumulated. But what they do remember is that he was one of the most dynamic offensive players in the history of the game.
A beautiful goal by Valery Kharlamov.
Kharlamov is an incredible hockey player. I think Yakishev and Kharlamov stood out, I guess. They were all incredible hockey players, but they had that star quality to them. You talk to the Russians, and the Russians would tell you that Kharlamov is an incredible, gifted, talented hockey player. He did it all.
The skill level of Valery Kharlamov was unbelievable. Such a coordination, the way he controlled the puck, the way his footwork on the ice, you know, it's a, you know, some players couldn't do that at this time. Yeah, but he was unbelievable.
Most players in the Hall of Fame have had people follow their careers from the time they were in junior hockey or even earlier. But Valery is different. He played for the powerful Central Red Army team, of which very little was known until the Summit Series of 1972. In the first game of that series, Valery became known to anyone who had ever watched a hockey game. A virtual unknown, He scored twice and was voted the game's MVP, leading the Soviets to a victory that stunned the Canadians and shook the hockey world to its foundation.
First game, we knew that he had to shut down. In fact, our line, basically Ronnie Ellis, did an incredible job watching him. Probably one of the best defensive hockey players that ever played the game was Ronnie Ellis. And Ronnie's played a lot of time. Our line played a lot of time against Karlamov. And that's how much respect we had right after the first game. This guy, we got to shut this guy down.
Unfortunately for Kharlamov, his Summit Series experience was about to change. A slash in Game 6 caused him to miss the next game and rendered him ineffective for the final game. It may be the play in Kharlamov's career that most remember, which is unfair to a player who possessed his skill and offensive flair.
When it happened, everyone kind of got nervous, and it started in Moscow. So everyone didn't know what to think of it at first. And I don't think it was just Bobby Clark doing it on purpose. I think it was just an accident.
What Kharlamov should be remembered for is being part of one of the best lines in the history of hockey, playing alongside Boris Mikhailov and Vladimir Petrov. The three players were the top unit for the Red Army's hockey powerhouse. Valerie played on 11 Soviet championship teams and won 8 world championships. He also captured gold medals at the 1972 and 76 Olympics. Shortly after scoring the game-winning goal at the 76 games, Kharlamov was seriously injured in a car accident, and his hockey future seemed in doubt. He did recover to play at the 1980 Olympics, but 1 year later, another car accident claimed his life. He was only 33.
We went over to Russia in 2002. We passed where he'd had his car crash. And we stopped the bus, and they had a monument to him. And had a puck and a stick, and it was really nice. And so we gave him a little, how you doing? And we haven't forgotten yet.
When Valery Kharlamov was in his prime, Russian players weren't allowed to play in the NHL. If they had, many feel he would have been one of the game's greatest stars. And people would recite his statistics alongside the legendary players that he joins by entering the Hockey Hall of Fame. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight we honor Valery Kharlamov, inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame in the player category. Accepting on his behalf is his son, Alexander.
Thank you. I can speak a lot like Murray, but I'm tired. Dear friends, thank you for this nice reception in memory of my father. We are so touched that so many people know and remember our father. Thank you again for organization our visit. I want to say special thanks for my father teammates who's come with me in this ceremony. It's Valery Vasilyev and Alexander Yakushev, Viktor Kuzkin, Alexey Kasatonov, Slava Fetisov, and myself and my family, my sister and my wife and my brother-in-law, we very proud and so happy to be here tonight. So thanks a lot for everyone.
The induction ceremony is the culmination of a busy weekend at the Hall. We'll look at the festivities surrounding the Hall of Fame weekend, including the Legends Classic.
This Sports Center update is brought to you by Tim Hortons New Southwest Chicken Sandwich.
Hey everybody, welcome to the SportsCenter Newsroom. I'm Jennifer Hedger. The next edition of SportsCenter comes your way at 11 Eastern tonight. Here's what we're working on for the big show NHL action for you. The Penguins on the ice tonight and taking on the Rangers. Sidney Crosby playing his first game with the Garden in the first. Crosby jumps past the Rangers D and he nearly scores from his knees, but not quite. Later in the first, Sergei Gonchar finds Mario Lemieux. That's a 6 of the season. It's 1-0 Pittsburgh after one. Philadelphia Eagles have suspended star receiver Terrell Owens for 4 games without pay, and following that suspension, Owens will probably be deactivated for the rest of the season. The suspension comes from a large number of situations, including a fight between Owens and former Eagle Hugh Douglas, and because he's pretty much an all-around jerk. We'll have more from the Hockey Hall of Fame induction ceremony coming up next on TSN.
When design impacts performance, performance returns the favor. The 6-speed, 298-horsepower G35. Behold the shape of performance. Infinity. A line has been drawn.
Say goodbye to cordless tools as you know them. No more clutter of different size batteries. No more rummaging for the right charger. With the new Ryobi One Plus system, you can get a wide range of tools for a lot less, because you don't have to buy a battery each and every time. And you can get it only at the home of innovation, the Home Depot. You can do it, we can help.
Right now, pick up a free WoodPro kit at a Steel dealer near you. Get real power. Steel. Built to last. Priced to sell.
This week on Choices, a young woman has a Wendy's classic single combo and a dilemma. Pick one of 5 delicious sides at no extra cost. But who's it gonna be?
Ma'am? Caesar side salad.
Do Wendy's. Do what tastes right.
Induction weekend is one of the busiest times of the year at the Hockey Hall of Fame. The festivities got underway Friday with a visit by the Stanley Cup champion Tampa Bay Lightning. The team was on hand for an autograph signing in the MCI Great Hall. Later, the Lightning players took the opportunity to watch Stanley Cup Odyssey, a short film recapping their triumphant Stanley Cup journey in 2004. On Saturday, hockey fans had the opportunity to have their picture taken with the Stanley Cup. To make the picture even more special, honored members were present, making every picture a memorable one. Lucky fans also had the opportunity to match their hockey skills against a legend in a game of shutout. Later that evening, this year's inductees took part in the ceremonial face-off at the annual Hall of Fame game featuring the Tampa Bay Lightning and the Toronto Maple Leafs. One of the more popular events each year is Sunday's Fan Forum. It gives hockey fans an opportunity to ask questions of this year's inductees. With a casual atmosphere, the forum is an enjoyable time for both the fans and the inductees.
I think it's a wonderful thing to do this fan forum. It's great to sit there and field questions from the true fans that are very passionate about the game, and try to give them a little bit of an insight to our thoughts. I think it's a great part of the weekend.
After the fan forum, honored members hurry to the Air Canada Centre for the Hockey Hall of Fame Legends Classic Heritage Game. Prior to the game, the official blazer presentation was made to each of this year's inductees. After the ceremony was complete, the Canadian legends and the Russian legends treated hockey fans to an afternoon of hockey and fun.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Commissioner of the National Hockey League, Gary Bettman.
Good evening, everyone. This is one of the special moments of our year. We gather in this great hall, we acknowledge exceptional accomplishments by outstanding individuals. We pay tribute to the skills and qualities that earn them hockey immortality. We take the opportunity to express our thanks for the things they did that made us so proud so many times to be hockey fans. So I would like to add the National Hockey League's voice to the chorus of congratulations for Cam Neely, Murray Costello, and Valerie Harlamov. Let me express as well our respect and appreciation to media honorees Helene Elliott and Sal Messina. The selection committee has done its difficult job extremely well. It has distinguished itself by adding this distinguished group to the roster of hockey legends. The walls of this great hall will be just a little more crowded when these new plaques are placed on permanent display, and the legacy of our game will be that much better defined for for generations of hockey fans to come. Thank you and enjoy the rest of the evening.
Thank you, Mr. Bettman. Let's move on to a part of tonight's agenda where my colleagues in print journalism and broadcasting are honored. The Foster Hewitt Memorial Award is awarded for excellence in radio and television broadcasting, and the Elmer Ferguson Memorial Award is presented to recognize outstanding work in the field of hockey journalism. Earlier today, the Foster Hewitt Award was presented to Sal Messina, the voice of the New York Rangers, and what a voice he was. Messina and his infectious Queens accent brought a drama, excitement, and a slice of New York showbiz to the Rangers broadcast for over three decades. And the Elmer Ferguson Award, very deservedly, was presented to Helene Elliott, currently a writer for the Los Angeles Times. During her three decades of writing about hockey, Helene has been a pioneer for female sports journalists while raising the bar for style and accuracy among her entire profession.
For the last three decades, hockey fans have relied on the words of Helene Elliott for the latest news and information on the sport they love. Since the Miracle on Ice in 1980, Elliott has been providing her readers with literary snapshots of hockey history. Her career began in Chicago and New York before moving west, where she currently writes for the Los Angeles Times as their NHL and Olympic columnist. In recognition of her distinguished writing, Helene Elliott is this year's winner of the Elmer Ferguson Memorial Award.
If we journalists seem to be overly critical of the game sometimes, I think it's because sometimes we're not sure the people who run this game know what a treasure they have. And it really is a treasure.
Growing up in Queens, New York, Sal Messina couldn't have imagined the relationship he would develop with the New York Rangers. After years as a minor league goaltender, Messina made the jump to broadcasting in 1973. For the next 30 years, he provided Rangers fans with exciting analysis on both the Madison Square Garden's radio and television networks. Sal enjoyed every aspect of the game and helped out wherever he could. He served as a practice goalie, official scorer, penalty timekeeper, and goal judge for the Rangers. Whatever needed to be done, Sal was there. Sal Messina is this year's recipient of the Foster Hewitt Memorial Award.
I couldn't dream to be in the same company and as the greatest ever associated in the broadcasting industry. Of course, Foster Hewitt, Dick Irvin, the late Dan Kelly, Jiggs McDonald, Chuck Caton, Jim Robeson. Broadcasters, along with all the builders and players and writers. And for that, I humbly say thank you to each and to the great game of hockey, which is the best in the world. Thank you very much.
He was the perennial power forward, blessed with a goal scorer's touch and the heart of a warrior. Everyone took notice when Cam Neely stepped onto the ice.
I certainly like to get a big check, a big hit in early in the game to kind of set the tone.
Thanks for a wonderful evening.
It's my pleasure. Hey, is this your car?
Not on a first date. But, you want some coffee?
Oh, yeah.
The 265 horsepower Nissan Maxima.
You know what?
What?
This next scene always makes me laugh.
See, unless you get a little bit crazy.
Again?
Oh, no, we'll never survive.
Beaten.
Want incredible entertainment experiences in your lap? Get Intel Centrino mobile technology in your laptop.
Home, stop cooking with
cheese!
Sounds like you got a tough one there.
No problem.
What is that, a drill?
It's a lot more than just a drill. It's my new Mastercraft Maximum 3KO impact gun from Canadian Tire. Three knockout tools in one. An impact gun, a driver, and a drill. Plus, I get all these accessories.
Powerful?
It has three times more power than a regular 14-volt drill. That's enough power to drill easily with cement or brick. And with the quick release, changing bits on the fly is a snap.
Did I see you using it to fix your deck?
Yeah, it's great for all kinds of work. And the impacting mechanism kicks in right when you need it to.
Fastening, driving, and drilling.
All at the press of a button. The Mastercraft Maximum 3KO impact gun with accessories is just $149.99. Now that's different, and only at Canadian Tire.
There's a rusty one. Let me give it a try. Wow.
I'll start with you.
The highlight of any visit to the Hockey Hall of Fame is the MCI Great Hall, the core sanctuary of hockey's proud history. After 32 years in Toronto's Canadian National Exhibition Grounds, the Hockey Hall of Fame opened its doors at BCE Place in June 1993. Built in 1885, within 10 years of the birth of hockey, the majestically restored heritage building at Yonge and Front symbolized the importance of banking in the formation of a country in much the same way that it now symbolizes the importance of hockey in Canadian culture. Inside, backlit glass walls reveal etched portraits and biographical sketches of each individual elected and inducted into honored membership. The centerpiece, flanked by the greatest collection of silverware in the world of sports, including the Vezina, Hart, and Calder trophies, stands the most famous and coveted of them all, the Stanley Cup. With tonight's ceremony, this will be the 13th consecutive year that this historic bank building has provided the ambiance-rich setting for the induction of hockey's newest legends. The MCI Great Hall, the magnificent home of hockey's legends, and a cathedral for the icons of hockey.
One of the highest unofficial honors in hockey comes when fans universally acknowledge that a certain player is a true Canadian or an ultimate Red Wing. Now, fans of the Boston Bruins are not easily impressed, so when their faithful say he's a real Bruin, that has significance and street credibility. Our next and final inductee tonight was unanimously viewed as the quintessential Bruin, who typified the values of the franchise established by the likes of Orr, Esposito, O'Reilly, and Bork. He began his career in Vancouver, but in moving away, he found his hockey home. In 10 seasons with the Bruins, this power forward redefined the concept of competing. Shift by shift, game by game, he carried his team and led by example. And when he returned from injuries that would have ended most careers, he took his game to another level, making the impossible possible. The hockey world marveled at Cam Neely, then, as we do here tonight, by honoring him with something we all knew this real Bruin had coming, a place in the Hockey Hall of Fame.
June 6, 1986, marked the 21st birthday of Cam Neely and one of the best days in the history of the Boston Bruins. It was on this day that Boston completed a trade with the Vancouver Canucks, sending Barry Peterson to Vancouver in exchange for Neely and a first-round draft pick. At the time, it was thought that Vancouver had the upper hand in the deal, but as the years passed, it turned out to be one of the most one-sided deals in NHL history for the Bruins. His impact in Boston was immediate. He led the team with 36 goals in his first season, but it was his style of play that made him a fan favorite. Cam was a power forward, defining the very essence of the position. A punishing body checker, he would run over an opponent instead of going around them, doing whatever it took to get in position to score.
When I was younger, I used to be a little bit more of a finesse player until I got bigger and I couldn't go around people like I used to, so I tried going through them. You know, and to be quite honest with you, I loved giving a big hit as much as scoring a big goal. I mean, it just, I knew what it did for the team, and I knew what it did for myself, and I knew what it did for the other team.
Bruins fans can close their eyes and vividly remember number 8, barreling down the right wing and burying the puck into the net, or ruggedly holding his ground in front of the net to put in a rebound. Cam could score in different ways from different areas, but the bottom line was that he could put the puck in the net. He scored 50 or more goals three times, his best season being in 1989-90 when he scored 55 times. He finished his career with 395 goals and an additional 55 playoff goals, a Boston team record.
Took a great deal of pride in performing in the playoffs. I really, you know, you want to perform in the regular season, but playoffs is where it really counts and really matters. And I didn't want to be a player that had great regular seasons but didn't perform in the playoffs. You got, you know, Espo and obviously Orr and you know, those guys from the Big Bad Bruins in the 70s that, you know, won cups and played deep in the playoffs a number of years. For me to have the career playoff goals for record for the Bruins is quite an honor, and I'm very proud of that particular achievement.
In 1991, Cam had finished the regular season with 51 goals and led the Bruins into the conference final against Pittsburgh. It's there that his career changed. Cam suffered a thigh injury, one that would eventually lead to problems with his knee. He never played a full season again.
We flew home after that game, and I was very uncomfortable, and then, you know, the pain kind of subsided over the next couple days, but then I felt my thigh muscle start to get a little, you know, harder than it should have. So I went and saw a doctor, and he told me what was going on, and I realized it was much more serious than just a Charlie horse.
The pain never ceased, but for 5 years, Cam kept the dream of being able to play alive. In 1993-94, he played in 49 games and scored 50 goals. In fact, he scored 50 in 44 games, requiring the third fewest games to reach the 50-goal mark. After two more seasons, scoring 27 and 26 goals, the pain became unbearable, and one of Boston's most beloved athletes was forced into retirement.
My right hip injury is permanent. Permanent disability, which will prevent me from ever returning to professional hockey.
I wasn't prepared at all to walk away from the game, and I've always considered myself a hockey player, and wanted to be a hockey player until, like most athletes do, they want to be an athlete until they say they don't want to play anymore, but most of us unfortunately don't have that control.
The city of Boston has a rich history of embracing great athletes. These select few are revered and held in high esteem. Cam Neely played 10 seasons with the Bruins, and his impact on the organization and the city places him in elite company with the top sports figures ever to perform in Boston. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Cam Neely, inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame in the player category.
Kind of hoping they wouldn't get the nose as accurate as they did on that. So, thank you so very much. I'm humbled to join hockey's greatest team today. And I want to thank the selection committee for recognizing me for something I love doing, but also for the way that I played the game. I would also like to thank Kelly Massey and staff at the Hockey Hall of Fame for a wonderful weekend for my family and friends. You've shown us a great time. Family, friends, former teammates, opponents, and fans, I'm extremely flattered by your appreciation of my career accomplishments. I would also like to congratulate Murray Costello and the late Valerie Karmeloff and their families on your appreciation of their wonderful careers. I'm honored to be entering the hall alongside of them. Like all of the players that have joined the Hockey Hall of Fame before me and those that will follow, our commonality is that we never dreamt of ending here. We did, though, dream of playing in the NHL. I loved playing hockey. And by the way, isn't it great that hockey's back? I loved playing it as a mite, a peewee, a bantam, winning the Memorial Cup with the Portland Winterhawks as a junior, and right through my time as a professional. However, there was that one brief instant in my life, a moment of misguided youth, I actually wanted to quit hockey. I was 15 years old and playing in my first year of midgets. All of my teammates were 16 and they were driving cars to and from games. Well, there I was heading home with Dad after games. I felt so out of place. I told my dad I wanted to quit. My dad gave me one of life's great lessons. He said, "Cam, you know what? You tried out for this team and you made it. You took someone else's spot and I want you to honor your commitment and finish the year." He continued, "If you don't want to sign up to play next year, that's your choice. No yelling, no screaming, just a valuable opportunity to grow up and make my own decision. To say the least, I'm very glad that I continued, and I'm profoundly indebted to my dad for that great lesson in life on commitment." To my brother Scott, sisters Christine and Sean, you deserve an enormous amount of thanks for the support you have given me over the years. My mother and father, my biggest supporters, I know you are watching and here with us today. I love you and I miss you. Their gift of giving is another life lesson that is very much an important aspect of my life to this day. I thank them from the bottom of my heart. I will never forget the kindnesses extended to me by my friends. In particular, I would like to thank Maxie and the entire Offenberger family for their generosity and friendship during a critical point in my life. I was just traded from the Vancouver Canucks to the Boston Bruins. My mother was sick, and my father was not well either. I was invited to move into the Offenberger home with the intent of staying till I got my feet on the ground. I ended up staying 3 years. Their gift of giving was of themselves. I'm touched by their gracious gift every day. Importantly, I also want to say thank you to every teammate, coach, members of the various training staffs from both the Vancouver Canucks and the Boston Bruins organization. And just as notably, my opponents. Well, not all of them, but. You made the game fun for me, as well as challenged me every day. The Canucks gave me the opportunity to play in the NHL, and the Bruins nurtured my growth as a professional hockey player. They also gave me the opportunity to work hard every day, compete toward a common goal, and honor the tradition of all who wore the Bruins jersey. My teammates and I all knew that the name on the front meant a lot more than the name on the back. My memory of these gifts and opportunities mean the world to me, especially on a day like today. I remember well the gift of giving by the fans. Their support extended beyond the game. I will never forget their compassion during my personal battles with the illness of my parents or with my professional battles with injury. I thank them deeply and sincerely. While I'm gratified today to be recognized for hard work and achievement, I also know that this was part of my life's work. As we examine our lives, and certainly we all come from different walks of life, different parts of the world, we do share a common humanity. We believe that life's purpose is to give to others whenever possible. Sometimes it's an event that reaches deep within us that causes us to give back. Personally, when I lost both my parents after their courageous battles with cancer, a direction in my life became abundantly clear. I realized many more things about my life and my parents' passing. As a professional athlete, I have been given so much. But today, I had satisfaction from giving back. Built my dreams. I want to give back to family and friends and others that have encouraged me. I want to give back to those who I may have the privilege and responsibility to help in their time of need. Many have helped me along the way, and it's my honor and responsibility to return the favor. As you all know, and I have learned well from you, there is no better gift than giving. I thank you again for this terrific lesson. I will never forget it. Finally, and most importantly, I want to thank and acknowledge my family. Without their loving and giving support, I could never accomplish my own personal goals. I'm blessed to have a wonderful wife, Paulina, the beauty, brains, and heart of our family, two wonderful children, Jack and Ava, who fill our home with love every day. Everything in my life is second to you. I love you all so very much. Today's honor means so much to me because I'm able to celebrate the greatest day in my professional career with my family. In closing, I thank all of you for today's prestigious remembrance. I am overcome that you have given to me yet again. Thank you, and God bless you.
That concludes tonight's ceremony. Congratulations to the new inductees, Marie Costello, Cam Neely, and to the family and friends of Valerie Halmaroff.
Each inductee has found a deserved place in hockey history tonight. We thank them for their passion and for their unique contributions to this great sport.
And thanks once again to everyone here at the Hall of Fame for another terrific hockey celebration. Finally, thanks to you, the fans, and to everyone here tonight for joining us. Good night.
Good night.
The 2005 Hockey Hall of Fame induction ceremony is brought to you by Molson Canadian, by the Kodak Easy Share System, digital pictures made simple, by Hugo Boss, by the Royal Canadian Mint, and by RBC, putting athletes first since 1947.
I smell gifts. Wait a minute, is that Pegasus Barbie from Canadian Tire? Susie'll love it. A 14? No, that's a 18-volt Mastercraft cordless drill. A remote-control car. Oh, with an MP3 hookup. Just what Billy wanted. How do moms do it?
For gifts that get great reactions, the best place to start is Canadian Tire.
Well done, Mom. I'm speechless.
I'll start with you.
True Canadian taste from Canada's oldest brewery, it starts here.
Who put this music on?
Molson Canadian Lager.
We got a report on a missing computer.
I don't understand.
This is a digital camera.
Right.
And this is a digital printer.
Right.
Then where's the computer?
There isn't one.
No computer. So where did the pictures come from? Simple.
The Kodak Easy Share camera and printer dock. Real Kodak pictures, real simple.
But that still doesn't explain what happened to the computer.
It doesn't?
Keep it simple. Keep it Kodak.
Fragrance for men.
What inspires gratitude? The Royal Canadian Mint presents this 25-cent coin to commemorate the Year of the Veteran. An opportunity to honor the veterans of yesterday, today, and tomorrow.
We thought it was important to serve, and I'd do it again.
I wanted to do my part. It's something I really believe in.
Collect this circulation coin to remember their contributions and sacrifices. Salute all veterans with this unique collectible from your change.
We couldn't lose. We had the Maple Leaf on our jerseys. The Royal Bank helped pay our way to the games. We won gold.
What I do takes discipline. RBC helped fund snowboarding through 2010.
My job is to go big or go home. RBC support helps me do my job.
RBC, putting athletes first since 1947.
James Duffy back with you. The three new members of the Hockey Hall of Fame getting ready to sign the Hall of Fame register. In many ways, this trio encompasses the game. It's the perfect trio for the Hall. An NHL pro, an international star, and a builder of the amateur game. all new members of the Hockey Hall of Fame. Good night.
Due to the length of the preceding program, we now join scheduled programming already in progress.
Considerably, you know, an easy fight for Floyd, a six-round devastation, basically a walkover. And to finish up his year, he's going to fight Charmaine Mitchell, another good...
Five and then six of them from the Nakoon tribe, and things aren't looking very...
Tree Nell brought...